as a particular case involves leaders, the RDCs, for instance, the district planners, the heads of departments, of districts from Puheju, from all these places, and other actors who are not necessarily government officials, including civil society organizations, including people from the media fraternity like you, like yourselves, and presentations are made, contributions are made, and reports therefore are generated. One of the areas, that's one of the areas, for instance, of public participation. One of the challenges that we seem to see nonetheless, and therefore the lower score at the end of the day, in spite of that process, for instance, is that we've seen that the reports where people have made their input, people of Nakasongora, Ruwera, and have made their input and would wish to have a leather factory, for instance, in the Ruwera Nakasongora area, that the people of Abim, the people of Nakapiripirit and Kotido, we, because of having a lot of livestock in that area, would wish to have a leather factory in Moroto Industrial Park, that at the end of the day, we don't see that in the final budget priorities. So it means then your process becomes more or less a ritual, and that's a challenge. So while the Ministry of Finance has done a lot of good effort to open up, to coordinate the opening up of people to influence the budget process, to influence government budgeting thinking, we don't see that thinking filter through up the end of the tunnel of the final budget priorities. So at the end of, at the time of scoring, would follow that kind of case.
What did this,
and when the a lot of input does not, a lot of input in terms of ideas and money and time, but does not translate into the final budget priorities,
it's not reflected at all,
then you get a lower score.
That is the 22.
So those are some of the areas of why the inclusiveness itself is getting a challenge. There are those that have suggested, look, learning from the case of Kenya, for instance, that you can have kind of a citizens' participation bill sponsored in parliament, and then it is able to be processed through as a law to guide this country. That at while the participation, those forums are there, the manner in which it should actually happen, if I have given, we've given you ideas, and this is the general consensus about the need for a leather factory in the Ruweru Nakasongora areas, but we don't see it Ngoma, and we don't see it at the end of the day, what is our recourse? If there was a law, we would take you to court and compare you, because this was the consensus that us, the people from Ngoma, Nakasongora, and Ruweru agreed to as the main budget item that we would wish to see. To the extent that it is not reflected in the final budget priorities, would take you to court and ask for redress. But that kind of mechanism is not there. So there are still gaps or certain areas we think we can plug and be able to improve the budget outcomes, outputs and outcomes in this country.
Well, that is the element of public participation in the budget process. That was at 22 out of 100. That is how Uganda we are doing in the research that was carried in 117 countries. The other element that I want us to discuss, if you read through this research, is the levels of transparency. And that is, we are standing at 58. This is impressive regarding the budget process. But I also, I have
shocking
a question on that.
Very
I have a question later, but I want Kapwepe to first explain to us, how did you arrive at the 58% in terms of transparency of our budget process or our budget entirely?
Okay. Thank you, moderator. 58, first and foremost, I should say, is not a pass mark as you indicated earlier on. It is actually failure.
Yeah.
The pass mark, the standard for any of the three parameters we've talked about, budget transparency, citizens' participation, and budget oversight, the pass mark is 60%. If you don't have a 60, and here there is no purgatory, there is no, say, let me wait here, you either have or you don't, plus 60% plus. So in Uganda in 2019, we have 58. In 2012, we actually had 65. In 2017, we had 60. In 2019, we are at 19. There is a bit of overall decline in the transparency. So that's the first bit. The second bit is that it looks high compared to the other two pillars that we are looking at. But 58% itself is not a pass mark. You're already below the pass mark. But also, Uganda at 58 is ahead of a number of countries. It is also possible that, for instance, in the region, Kenya, Rwanda, Comoros is actually at zero on all the parameters. It is possible that you can be transparent in the case of Uganda, say, but we don't see that transparency walk through to the level of actual service delivery outputs and outcomes. I'll give you an example. It is possible that the transparency says that when I'm working on the Guru or Wiyo Road, I should put up a signpost that tells me who the contractor is, when the project starts, the project start time and end time, the amount of money involved, the subcontractor, and all this. It is also possible that at site, a site manager, a site engineer can have the detailed project documents. This road shall be 70 kilometers, it will be 6 meters wide, it will be tarmac, and it will have two layers. Of course, I'm simplifying it from the technical language of contractors. That is the transparency we are talking about, because we are asking, is information available? And that would be one of the indicators that yes, so that's a mark, information is available. It is also possible that people around Orwio, the people around Anaka, that the majority, if not all, have not gone even at that project site to look at that particular signpost. It is also possible that when they have looked at that signpost, they have not gone ahead to say, oh, since it is 70 kilometers, so can we ask the other sub-county chief on the other side, Ramesh, on the other side, to see whether those guys have reached. It was supposed to be 6 months. We see it's 2 years as an example through which this project should have been delivered. We are seeing now it is 3 years. What has happened? That people don't get that level, and therefore you can have transparency here, but that may not filter through unless there is civic consciousness. Karl Marx calls it civic consciousness.
So what, briefly, Kapwepwe, what are some of the evidences of transparency in this process? You've just given us one where it is mandatory for every government project to have that signpost or billboard or whatever showing the contract and that. So give us some of the other avenues that really one can really...
That puts Uganda at
58.
What is it doing?
Yes.
Actually, it has been above the mark, as you gave.
Below. It's below.
No, above, previously.
Previously, it has been above the mark.
What are some of the things that have put it there?
So I'll just look at two areas. One is in respect to availability of data or information to the public. One of the areas we check is with now increased internet connectivity and all this, and the world is moving on, is progressing. We check, is this there are some key eight budget documents that we check about their availability. One of the ways of the availability is online availability. Are they on website? Because government institutions now have websites. Actually, as a country, we have a website where you can find finances, government plans, all in one docket, and the expenditures so far that have been done. But is that updated?
Okay, so that
remember, when we are looking for this data, we are also looking at timeliness. If a financial year, if a quarter has ended, third quarter has ended, at April or second quarter has ended at December 31st. After how long do we see reports?
Okay. End of financial year. Element, yes,
that is one area. The other one we look at is that document comprehensive? I'll give like a quick example on the comprehensiveness. If you say that as a country we are going to get 20 trillion through domestic revenues, you tend to see only the money from direct taxes. But the money, like I alluded to earlier on, say from Makerere, where we pay a 50,000 to get a form, and cumulatively it will be millions of money, that you don't see that type of money reflected here across the government institutions that we interact with, as an example. So those are some of the areas that we look at. The other bit we look at is how easy there is what we call a citizen's budget document, that out of this big budget document approved, we need something we call a citizen's budget. All I need is for you to say that in Mitiana or in Chiindi, on the way to Vuvuma, we shall have a ferry rejuvenated this financial year. That from Bukakata to Sese Islands, we shall have a new ferry which is coming aboard. I don't need the other technical difficult languages, the money will come from, as you have already seen in some of these budget documents. So the simplicity of budget information another area that we for instance we look at. So those are some of the quick examples I can give you.
Julius, also interesting in this report, another good score, that is 59 when it comes to the oversight role, budget oversight. These are interesting statistics. And sometimes, let Julius first explain, but I have some questions I'm going to ask you, Julius, regarding this. So here, how do you get to a 59?
59, mainly we look at the role of parliament in inviting citizens to participate in the approval process. We also look at parliament and how it followed through the implementation. You have passed a budget to Ministry of Health. It is supposed to complete Kabong Hospital. It is supposed to under the African Development Bank financing, to complete Kaolo Hospital in Lugazi and complete Yumbe Hospital. So members of parliament, has that happened? When it has happened, then we can know that you are following your kind of your money that you approved then. Now we don't see a lot of that happening. The other bit is that at the level of Auditor General, the Auditor General actually as a subcomponent of budget oversight has even a higher mark, because for them they go and audit and produce reports. But and that's a good thing. So there are two elements. One is that we are not seeing when those good reports have been produced and presented at parliament. We are not seeing the follow through in terms of action. There is very minimal action.
In other words,
but the question would be,
yes, but let me just quickly do this one, that you have presented at parliament and we have said so much money was stolen or we have concerns here, that we expect through a parliamentary process and any other processes recovery of that kind of money. When that doesn't happen, the good work that has been done by the Auditor General is simply inflated, is deflated.
But the question is, when you talk about oversight, who are the primary parties to do this? You seem to put to us, still it is supposed to be government, because Auditor General is government, Parliament is government. Are these the only stakeholders in your report that you consider?
In our report, those are the two institutions we consider, but also to the extent to which they involve the people. And I'll give you an example. You can have an office of Auditor General based for the region, based in Mbarara town. For the region, Sinjiro, Chiruhura, and a number of these. When we have issues with the Isinjiro District Administration official, we also think it would be imperative that as an office of the Auditor General, you let people know that on the 14th of this month, we shall be in the Sinjiro district and we shall be dealing with this particular matter. So that people who are residents...
The Baraza way.
people who are residents in that area are actually able to volunteer information. They say, by the way, we are investigating this road, but we know for a fact that a tire of this grader or tractor was actually taken by Musa.
But does that happen?
That's the whole point.
Because that's the whole point. To inform now
that's the whole
statistics
point
that
it is
give.
Not happening. Mm. And that's the whole point that we are inviting Ugandans that we must do our part. So that's the whole point that we are reminding Parliament and Auditor General that there is an opportunity for that to happen. When that happens, in the next round in 2022, we shall improve our score as a country. And it's even a good thing, regardless of these types of researches. It is our democratic right as Mwananchi who pay taxes that we know what our governments are doing. Precisely, leave alone the discussions of the researches. I don't. It is upon us. If that does not happen, then we shall continue to have service delivery gaps to that extent.
Well, Julius, now after we've looked at that is transparency at 58%, we've looked at that is public participation at 22%, then we see oversight at 59%. This is the disturbing question. I've read your report thorough almost overnight.
Yeah.
Since yesterday. But one question that comes to my mind.
Yes, yes.
Why isn't this reflected in service delivery? If these statistics are right, if in Africa we are second, in East Africa we are the best, but how then do we, when you look at the corruption index, that is what you call it?
The corruption perception index.
Perception index.
Yes.
It ranks us, I don't even want to mention where we stand.
Yes.
So please give us a balance of that
yes.
for layman to understand these
yes.
statistics.
Theoretically, there should be a transparency and good transparency
yes.
or high level transparency nexus with high level service delivery.
Mm. Which is not.
Precisely the Orwio Guru case of the road that I've shared with you. That you are transparent here.
Mm-hmm.
The information is available. But if you do not have like somebody to check and confirm with the contractor that the contractor has actually delivered, that you can have a Tororo Mbare Soroti road which is due for construction in after about 5 years of being delivered. That's precisely the point. That you can have the transparency here and you show we shall be using so much money on this particular road. But if the citizens at that around Tirinyikamonkoli area are not active in protecting what government has delivered that side for their good and for the good of the country, we all use these roads. That instead you are participating in the steering of the tire, that you are participating in the steering of the fuel, that you are part of the problem rather than part of the solution, you definitely can have high levels of transparency here. We even announced on radio at Open Gate FM in Bale, we announced that this road will be commissioned. Even when it was being commissioned, we held a ceremony and gave people information about who the contractor is, what is the kilometer to be covered, how much money is involved, what will be the period of implementation. But the people on the other side are the ones involved in steering of fuel. So you have lesser service delivery, or you deliver this particular road project at a higher cost. So yes, theoretically you should be higher transparency, higher service delivery outputs and outcomes on the other side. In the case of Uganda, that does not necessarily filter through, and that is reflected in some of these law marks.
Yes. Finally, time is not our best ally, but what are some of the recommendations after such a very interesting report? That is the Open Budget Survey Report. I hope all Ugandans can get hands on it. This is the 7th edition, by the way.
Yeah.
These reports have been coming in, though our performance has been deteriorating. But what are some of your recommendations that you can put forward to government and, of course, the public?
Yeah, one of the recommendations precisely include part of what I've touched on, that it is imperative that we see more comprehensive reports. If as a country we say this will be our basket of revenues to finance this financial year, We want a full picture, disclosure of how we are standing both for what we call tax and non-tax revenues. And I gave an example of non-tax revenues, that if you want to a travel document, you go and pay at immigration offices. That is not a tax. It is a non-tax, but it's an income to the state. If you are being fined at a road for some bit of bad driving, say, or something, that money should go into the state coffers and be reflected here. Mm-hmm. How much did we fetch last year, for instance? You will rarely find it.
The other bit we
are inviting government to, and we'll continue with these conversations at Parliament, Finance, Inspectorate of Government, and Auditor General, is that the quarterly reports, for instance, that are produced by ministries, by departments, by local governments, should be shared out and put online and published in hard copies to be available to the Mwananchi. You don't wait just for a financial report. The other bit we would wish to see is, let us support the Auditor General to do their work. When these good reports have been produced and laid before Parliament, those culpable should answer. The stolen resources should come back into the state coffers. Those resources belong to Ugandans, they don't belong to individuals.
Well, I want to thank you. That is Julius Kapwepwe, who is the Director of Programs Uganda at this network. We've been looking at, that is the Open Budget Survey Report that was launched yesterday, and putting Uganda, that is, ranking 36 out of 117 countries where the surveys were carried out, and with a pass mark of 58, still below the mark, but that is what we managed to score. And of course, we're the best in East Africa, second in Africa, that is South Africa, toppling the transparency levels. We've been looking at areas of transparency, public participation, and budget oversight. This report is public information.
Yeah.
Let's read the report, see some of these recommendations, how best, so that we have this also transformed into service delivery. Of course, all this can be only if we fight the cancer corruption. From me, Felix Nkunda, my co-host, then the entire technical team, Fiona there, Davis, Brother Ratoro, NASA, and so many that make it a point to say that this show is on air. I just want to wish you a lovely weekend. Please do not drink and drive. Have a mask on, and also ensure that you sanitize, wash your hands regularly. COVID is with us, hit the 1,000 mark. But of course, this success only takes you and me to be very careful of our lives. God bless you. Have a lovely weekend. See you on Monday, God willing. Same time, I'll leave you with the quote of the day. And Ruben will be here to take you through the world of sports. Don't miss also our Good Morning Uganda Extra with the man of his own hairstyle, that is Jagenda Semakula.